Xbox community, thanks for joining us. We're live from Gamescom right now, day two. My name is Bravo. I'm community manager at 343 Industries working on Halo. With me today is Max Hopeman, the original online and multiplayer design lead for Halo 2, also president of Certain Affinity, a studio that has a lot of history working on Halo games.
We do. We have way too much history. we've worked on Halo games since I started the company in 2006 with Halo 2. We did the Blastacular map pack for Halo 2. We've done. We worked on Halo Reach. We worked on Halo 4.
Yep.
Waypoint.
And now, of course,
Anniversary.
Yeah, Halo 2 Anniversary within the Master Chief Collection.
Master Chief Collection. Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. So we're going to talk a little.
We've
bit
done
about,
a few.
Yeah, we're going to talk a little bit about that today. I'm also going to show you a Sanctuary, which we just announced.
Tuesday. Which is we have on screen. You guys will see in a little bit.
Yeah.
Looks pretty awesome.
Just to give an update of what's going on with Halo here at Gamescom, we, as we said at our Xbox press briefing, we announced that Sanctuary is one of the fourth remastered map alongside...
Wait, so what's been announced so far?
Good call. Coagulation, right?
All right.
Zanzibar.
All right. What can I talk about?
Ascension.
Ascension.
And Sanctuary.
And Sanctuary.
Those are our four. We've got two more
so
maps.
So it's up two that we haven't announced
we've
yet.
We've got two more maps coming that we are going to announce later
right.
this year as we get closer to
I'll try not to slip up.
Yeah, no, I was very careful. I did not announce a map just now. I had to be very careful.
But, all right. Nice work.
Also announced the Halo Channel, which is a brand new app coming to Xbox One, which I'm really excited about. It will allow people to consume things like Halo Nightfall and also rewards tied into the game. So it'll be a whole new viewing experience for Halo Entertainment.
Yeah, it looks slick. It looks really cool.
Yeah, which is especially cool with Nightfall coming with the Master Chief Collection, too, I think.
Yep.
I think people are really going to like it, and also some of the kind of the gameplay and esports features that we have built.
Yeah, I was suggesting getting some behind the scenes at Certain Affinity
on
the channel. Do some episodes.
Let's do it. All right.
Let's do it.
I'm coming out.
That's a deal. That's a commitment. Right there.
Oh, crap. but yeah, we also announced, let's see, alongside Sanctuary, of course, we had the Halo 5 ViDoc, which was the first look at Halo 5. We also showed a little tease of what Midship looks like.
I saw that. I was surprised that you guys made that public.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
I heard about it secretly.
We kind of slipped that under there. So hopefully people like what they saw for Midship and also another map that we have not yet.
You know, but a little known fact about Midship?
Go.
First map that I ever designed for Halo.
That's amazing.
It's a good map.
That's amazing.
Worked out all right.
It is a great map.
Kearney helped me out a little, so it wasn't all by my lonesome. But it turned out all right.
It certainly did. I mean, especially, I think it has infamously lived on. And,
yes.
Whenever we talk about Halo 2, people immediately go to Midship.
Yep. Very cool.
Yeah, so I showed a little bit. If you guys want to see any of those videos, you can check out youtube.com/HaloWaypoint or also youtube.com/Xbox. We've got a look at all of the things we just talked about and more.
Off.
I think you guys I think you were talking about German players and shit. Anyway.
Yeah, that's where I'm going. Hey, what's up?
Hey,
we're back. All
we're
right.
back.
Yeah. So
sorry, technical difficulties apparently.
But hey, we're back. There's a lot of people in here. 350,000, I think, right? And they're all trying to use the same internet connection.
They're all trying to use the same internet connection.
And bathroom.
And restroom, urinals. It's
tough.
It's quite a scene.
It is. But this is, have you been to Gamescom before?
No, this is my first time. This is, it's crazy. This thing is huge.
Yeah, mine too. I'm going to have to upload some pictures, but...
I've been sending pictures to the crew back home.
To move people, they have like highways and underpasses, you know, within the convention center. And you just have, it looks like a scene from The Walking Dead.
Whenever there's a traffic jam, so these guys swoop in and they reroute people dynamically on the fly.
Well, actually, I've seen it. There was like you have to move like a half mile out of, because the escalators were only up now.
That's right.
So they reroute people down like this highway.
It's pretty impressive.
It's pretty wild.
We were talking about, you're saying there's a tournament on Sunday.
Yeah, we're
going to. I was asking if it's going to be live streamed.
Yeah, well, so we're going to have it at twitch.tv/Halo on Sunday. So it's starting 10:30 a.m. Central European Standard Time. It's around 1:30 a.m. back in the States.
Okay.
So, you'll depending on which coast you're on.
Is that the two, the finals? Is that
It's going to be the top eight teams.
Top eight, okay.
We worked with ESL to find some of the best European teams, and they invited them. And now each day on the show floor, we're taking the best team that plays at the Halo booth over in Hall 9. So you're going to have some of the best European talent going up against kind of teams that have a history.
Very cool.
So it should be pretty cool. It's going to be Golden Boy and myself commentating, and we're giving away $10,000 on Sunday. So I'm excited.
$10,000?
Yep.
Not euros.
It's U.S. dollars. Someone's going to have to convert that.
Yeah. Is it in cash? Did you bring it all?
I think it's in a large suitcase. Yeah, we're going to slam that thing right on stage.
Very cool.
Cool, but as we said, this past Tuesday we announced for the first time and kind of showed it off in a really cool way that Sanctuary is back in Halo 2 Anniversary. Yep. I got to say, in terms of how the map is looking, it's definitely one of my favorites. Let's talk a little bit about, before we jump into the build, Talk a little about Sanctuary and the Origins. It was part of it's the only DLC. It was one of the DLC maps.
Yes.
Yeah.
I won't say anything about what you just said.
Nope.
It's let's see. Sanctuary was one of the DLC maps that we released after we shipped Halo 2.
Yep.
I remember it was Steve Cotton's map, actually. Steve Cotton was one of the environment artists that I hired on and got midway through Halo 2.
Yep.
And we had such a small team that our environment artists doubled as level designers. Mm-hmm. So he came on kind of late, and I was telling you before, we had already designed a lot of the maps.
Yeah.
So it was really his first chance to get in there and get his hands on and really get to design his own map. So he did a lot of work on it.
That was the first chance he had to design his own map.
I think so. I think everything else was just helping us polish
between
the other ones.
Mitchell being your first map and this being his first map is
not
pretty,
bad.
It's
right?
Pretty incredible.
Yeah. So when we were working on this, I don't know why, but everyone used to any map that Steve Cotton would work on would be called something to do with cotton.
Uh-huh.
So this map's code name was actually Temple of Cotton.
I think it's fitting.
Until I finally had to rename it.
Yeah, we should actually, we'll hop into the build right now.
Yep.
And we'll go ahead and check out the gameplay if we can.
Yeah, so the team back at Certain Affinity's been working really hard to get this ready for Gamescom. And hopefully if you guys are seeing the live stream right now, get a glimpse of what this thing looks like. It looks amazing. It looks spectacular. Really happy.
I mean, it really does. And then the differentiation of the bases here, as you have kind of this overgrown ivy taking over this part, you see Ruined Temple on your screen.
Yep.
So the Temple of Cotton. I mean, and just the way the water flows through the map, and the fact that each
corner. That's all new. I don't think there was any water on the original.
Yeah, I think there was just a tiny bit that was on the map.
Oh, the puddles. That's right.
Yeah.
But that's right.
But you know, I mean, one of the cool things I think is that you can look at this map, and each corner of the skybox completely different.
Yep, and that's all very intentional because those are navigational aids.
Right.
So we're trying to, we'll see how it goes, but we don't want to just slap colors everywhere, red and blue, even though that works really well. I did it for a reason before.
Right.
We're going to test this out and see if we can differentiate based on shapes here, yet keep the symmetry of the map because it is a symmetrical map. That matters a lot.
Oh, of course.
So
yeah,
I think it's working pretty well.
Yeah, so I mean, playtesting this map, getting ready for Gamescom to show it off, and now finally seeing the map in players' hands.
It's very cool.
It's really cool this weekend to watch people compete on it and play it for the first time. The feedback has been really good. But we'll keep kind of touring around the outside of this map.
Yeah, you can see some of our awesome Skybox artists' work here.
Yeah.
I want to do a whole documentary for the channel, by the way, all about just creating skyboxes.
Yeah.
Because our guys are so good at it.
I mean, you are. If you look at also some of the Halo 4 stuff, like Skylines, Skybox.
Oh, yeah.
Also,
some of that stuff looks amazing.
Monolith, Skybox are really great.
Yeah, that's all our handiwork.
We can actually, as we're touring the map, Max, we can kind of talk about some of the new stuff that's been implemented as well. You want to start with the changes to the shotgun tunnel?
Yeah, well, we have to be really careful about what changes we make on here. Extremely deliberate. This is probably the most significant change.
Yep.
Very intentional, but if you turn to your right, look right there, and right there,
yep.
There's a jump pad, and that'll take you up, and that was not in the original map. But when we were playing through this and testing it and looking at it, we really thought that it was important to get that vertical flow in there.
Yeah.
Once you're in that shotgun hallway, you get a little bit locked in.
Yep.
Not bad to commit, but we really felt that ultimately it played a lot better with this lift in there. So
sure, yeah, I mean, I think
very careful about these changes, though.
Yeah, I think that's actually something I want to ask. I mean, when you look, how do you determine? Because I think for any kind of player, right, whether you're a casual player or a hardcore competitive player, this change really improves map flow greatly.
Yeah.
And I think what people are going to find is that, typically if you're running away from an angle here and you got stuck in this tunnel, like you said, you'd be trapped. And not only can you use it defensively, but I think also offensively, if there's a player on the sniper,
right,
you can go ahead and now retake control of that. So it makes people kind of watch their back a little bit more. When you're looking at the map, I mean, how did you start? When we're looking at Halo 2 Anniversary, did you play on the original a bunch and decide maybe what needed to be changed?
Yeah, we played on the original a ton. A bunch of us have experience. Obviously, I do, but other people at Certain Affinity also have experience with the maps. From the Halo 2 survived online for a really long time.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of good experience there. We went online and we talked to a whole lot of players. We looked at a lot of forums, and
sure,
we talked to we talked to you guys and a lot of the pros, and we just built a huge hit list of potential changes and problem areas.
Yeah.
When you do these maps the first time, there's always something here or there that you wish you could have done.
Sure.
Something that you wish you could change. Something that just didn't make it in because of art time or whatever.
Yeah.
So this was a big one. Getting kind of locked in that shotgun hallway and you know, kind of getting trapped with a dead end and just not having that mobility, you know, that freedom of movement, we really felt was problematic. So, you know, it, ultimately we tested out. We had some other stuff we tested too. This is the only really big one that stuck. Although we'll talk about the waterfalls in a minute, that's kind of a result of some other changes that we were considering that we ended up not making these other changes, and instead we added the water in there.
Yeah. Speaking of that, that was awesome. I mean, the water effects, absolutely incredible. If you see this water coming off the cliffs, I mean, and around here, something that I found by just playtesting was some of the lighting in here is incredible. If you see when a grenade goes off, you see where that, how the light, I mean, in the cave actually, you actually see it and completely light up here with all the water there. So the lighting effects are absolutely incredible as well.
Yeah.
But yeah, let's
this thing looks amazing. I'm really happy with how this turned out.
Yeah, I think it's something that not only does the map geometrically, and you know, in terms of the flow of the map, stay so true to the original, but I think even the evolution of the art design, you know, I think people are going to be, they're going to feel at home on Sanctuary.
I hope so. So far, so good. Everyone playtesting, but there's something else that we're really conscious of on here is maintaining all of the skill jumps and all the little, you know, all the little tiny subtleties. Really matter a lot to us. I know you guys, definitely a partnership with 343, you guys have helped us out a ton to identify those areas and preserve them, and I won't say whether we've added anything, but always discover something.
Yeah, I think we could look around for a few of those.
Can we talk about things we've added at all?
Oh yeah, I wanted to also point out the corner, like just this corner of the map so different from the, you know, the opposite catty corner of the map. So I think for visual cues, first of all, people are gonna be able to pick it up really quick. But also, I mean, just the fact that of how different this map has so much variety, even within just, you know, this small space. But yeah, let's talk about some of the new things that have been added. I think a lot of the skill jumps have been recreated. Something I know that's super important to you guys is making sure that all those skill gaps are still there for players.
Yeah, and then this one, if you, that rock, watch this. You can jump up there. That's
that's huge. A huge thing, because actually, I'm not sure, Max, if you had known this, but in Halo 2, Sanctuary for Tournaments was a map that we always played, and also sometimes we see standoffs. Because the map is symmetrical and has a 50-yard line, has two sniper rifles, see standoffs. So players,
I know, I placed all the weapons on it.
Yeah, so players here would actually boost up. I don't know if you've seen this. Players would stand on each other's head right here and actually boost up to the carbine bridge. It was done, if you wanted to surprise an opponent, you could actually jump up there and catch him off guard. But instead, I think a really cool thing is that this jump right here, able to improve map flow. Now you can break the...
Where were we? I think we were talking about trying to preserve some of the skill jumps and adding a few tweaks. You were talking about standing on people's heads over here.
Right. Thank you. Yeah, I think one thing that's cool is...
show people how you can get up on the...
So this jump right here over to what we call Ring 3 was a jump that people actually, I think the community discovered within the map, where you kind of...
I don't think that was intentional.
Yeah, you kind of notch yourself in Halo 2 and you'd pop out. Now, the jump... now a little bit more accessible. You can kind of just I think that might be the first time.
You know,
but now we have this rock here.
There's a reason that they call that a skill jump.
That's true. You're so right, Max. I think that's the first time that I'm going to blame it on the TV.
That is actually the first time that
I've ever missed it. All right. So you can kind of jump up to Ring 3 here, which is cool. And it still offers the same vantage point that it did in Halo 2, and it kind of offers the same cover. So certainly a power position, you know. From there, you can also, and what's cool is that I know at CA, you guys kind of had the list of skill jumps, and you made sure that if it existed in Halo 2 Classic, that it needed to be here in Halo 2 Anniversary, which is really cool, as I said.
Yeah, you know, there's another change that we made. This will be interesting to see the reaction, but in the center of the center building.
Yeah, we'll go ahead and see the Ring 3 up here as well.
Yeah, it's a little weapon change.
Yep.
I don't know if any...
Okay, let's talk about that a little bit. If anyone saw the 2v2 video that we did on Sanctuary for our announcement video, which you can find on Twitch... YouTube.com/Xbox as well as YouTube.com/Halo Waypoint. They saw the rocket launcher was in play.
In place of the sword, if I recall.
Yeah, so
I think I
saw
a sword hanging in midair on the original Sanctuary. Yeah.
Yeah. So talk about that change a little bit.
Well, you know, when, on the original one, if I recall, the sword had unlimited ammo. I think we added the charges to Halo 3.
Uh-huh.
Actually, during Halo 2 development, I remember being kind of frustrated, feeling like it was overpowered, which is why we really pushed to change it in 3. Mm-hmm. But we were playing around in here, we thought about adding the rocket, and we tested it out, and we just felt that it played way better.
Yep.
It's, you know, it's all, this map is, that while there's a few corners and little hidey holes and stuff, it's very much about ranged combat.
Yep.
And we really thought that getting that rocket in there, super powerful, but only a couple short bursts, a couple rockets, You know, it totally changed the game. It gave you some ways to get in. If you have people playing defensive at the base, if you're playing a CTF game, a rocket can also help break that stalemate that tends to develop.
Yeah.
So that was really important.
That's actually what I was going to say as well. So if you imagine the rockets being picked up in the middle, typically with the sword, you need to sneak into the enemy's base and kind of play very slowly. But when you do have the rocket launcher, you can use the cover of the plasma pistol bridge or maybe the rocks to then kind of bust into the base, right, and kind of clear it out. So I think it absolutely speeds up.
Yeah, in a way, I think at least on this map, the rocket ends up being a better offensive tool than defensive.
Right.
And defenders already have a lot of advantages on here. It's really hard. You get a good team, an organized team, it is really tough to break that, you know, break through those defenses.
Yeah, indeed. So speaking of defenses, actually, I think the counter to perhaps the person pushing into your base might be the addition of the waterfalls.
Well, yeah. So yeah, show them the waterfall.
Sure. So we're here. We have it on each base as a trigger.
So before you trigger that, originally I was actually pushing the team. I wanted to add a little back tunnel.
Yep.
So you had a back entrance that got you into the base.
Okay.
We actually experimented with it and we played with it.
Where was it on the map?
It would go from the rock field over here.
Yep.
And you'd go around to the left and there'd be a little tunnel entrance.
Okay, kind of.
That would loop you around and take you back up. But we felt it changed the map too much and it just wasn't working. It was kind of unnecessarily adding too much. So we wanted to give you some options. Actually, it's funny because the waterfall is not really a defensive tool.
Right.
It's more for attackers.
Uh-huh.
So go ahead and trigger that waterfall.
I was going to talk about that as well. Imagine if you do have control of the enemy's base, you can go ahead and turn that down.
You can trigger it from outside.
Yep.
So if you got a bunch of guys camping inside, you turn this on and now you block their line of sight.
Right.
And you know, now it makes it a hell of a lot harder for them. Now that they're forced to come out of the base and range out,
right,
you know, or else they have a much harder time seeing you coming.
Right.
So
yeah, I think that's one thing. I think we were discussing that it actually is a great tool that, you know, if someone's camping inside,
that's how I use it. Right, exactly. That's actually how I use it.
Yeah.
So it seems defensive in nature, but I actually think of it more of an offensive tool. And, you know, really, you know, whenever we're designing these maps, you want to take defenders and you want to encourage them to come out and not just camp their flag,
right,
to range out and risk their neck a little bit. So
sure.
I'm sure people will argue with me. It'll be interesting to see the offensive versus defensive advantage.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, just taking a stroll look around this map as well. But I think it's just, you know, the fact that the sight lines that people remember, the battles that they remember, you know, fighting from rockets to sniper, using the jump ups to get into ring two. I think people are going to, remember all the different encounters they had and memories on the map.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of nostalgia for this map. That was one of the reasons we picked it, actually.
Yeah.
Just, kind of look at all the different maps and, you know, what's been done a lot, what hasn't, what do people miss? What worked for casual play? What worked for competitive play?
Right.
You know, with this set, I know we're not talking about all the maps yet, but it was really hard to lock in on the six maps.
Yeah.
You know, we had to really think about not just any individual map, but what made a really complimentary set, because we only have six of them.
Yeah.
So what six maps that we feel really offer some awesome variety? I know that this map we really wanted because of the symmetry, the flag games, and that kind of thing. We were talking about midship earlier. It's got some of those, some of those symmetric aspects.
Oh, certainly, yeah. I mean, controlling the center of the map and then kind of branching out. Kind of what's cool about, you know, this ring three vantage point is it does give you a chance to look at the differentiation of the two sides.
Ooh, can you trigger the waterfall from there? I actually don't know.
I think let's see if that is
some skill. There you go. Awesome.
So we can.
But yeah, you know, we didn't have a ton of sort of small symmetric maps like this in the shipping game, actually.
Right.
And I remember when we were planning out the DLC, I laid out, here's the needs. We need a small map, symmetric. We need this, we need that. And then we had various groups that they kind of, everyone sort of grabbed one. And this was the, you know, we really need that small symmetric map for playing CTF type games. It seems like it works pretty well for Team Slayer also, though.
Oh, yeah.
It was designed first and foremost for CTF.
Yeah, we're going to see a lot of Team Slayer, on Sunday. I can't wait to get all
started. Now, you guys, for the tournament, you're doing BR Start on everything, right?
That's right, yeah. For the tournament, it's all BR Start, and if you do want to play on the Gamescom floor, you can try out Classic SMG Start.
So how's it working with the BR Start?
Oh, it's been awesome, man. I mean, we play test, I'm sure you guys do as well. Back home at 343, we play test quite a bit with both SMG and BR Start, and and everything feels great. It's been awesome to see just the response, not only in the studio, but now that the game is in everyone's hands, to see the response to the game. I mean, even just, I can't say enough good things about the way that the water looks coming down on these on the map. Yeah, so I think we have some questions here from fans. The first one comes from Brutality. She wants to know, Why did you choose Sanctuary over other maps? I think you talked about this a little bit, but can you maybe shed some more light on that?
Yeah, you know, I think just looking at the set of maps, we really felt that it really completed the set. And if you look at the maps we chose, it offered, you know, there were some maps we were looking at, like Beaver Creek, for instance,
right?
Which I think we remade in Halo 2. And we were looking at maps like that. It's like, well, but it's been done a lot. It's kind of an old... It's a Halo 2 map. We did it recently.
Yeah, I was going to say it did.
Didn't feel right, but there's some things about maps like Beaver Creek that we really want. So we looked around at, you know, maps that have that same, that, you know, still real tight, compact maps,
right.
CTF maps, symmetric, etc. And also,
we're back. Cool. All right, Max, we were answering some questions.
What else do you have there?
About Sanctuary and the maps that we're remastering.
Test my knowledge
here. We were just finishing Brutality's question about why Sanctuary. I think we talked a lot about, you know, symmetrical type map that offers quite a bit and different from other maps that were offered in Halo 2.
Well, I think it's also a good Slayer map, and that's always important.
Yep, indeed. Cool. So the next question actually was, do rockets and grenades move drunk through the waterfall?
Let's test that out. There you go.
Yeah, I think as you said, being an offensive tool, we would need kind of those things to go.
Yeah, that's a good question, though. I don't know if we ever considered not having them go through.
There's definitely a big difference.
It's really a visual blocker.
Yeah, there's definitely a big difference between something like a hard light shield, of course.
Yep.
And that. So let's see, our next question is, from Skywalker DSP. He wants to know, Do the maps have the AR in Halo 2 Anniversary?
Yes. Yeah. It should be on there. Where's that sucker?
Let's see. Wait. I don't know. You know. I don't know if I know offhand where this is.
Yeah. I don't know where it's placed offhand.
But we do have that.
Keep in mind, this is all in development.
There we are.
We made a few tweaks to some of the weapon placement, and I think really careful, really subtle stuff. But some of it's important.
I think. And for some people who haven't heard that the AR is back, might have missed our RTX panel. Let's talk a little about that, the role that fits in the sandbox.
Yeah, you know, the AR is, I think, hugely important. I think it's made a huge difference. We have a lot of short-range weapons, and we've got a lot of really powerful close-range, in particular because you can dual-wield. And then we've got a couple ranged weapons.
Yep.
And in that in-between range, there's really nothing. It's really very binary.
Yep.
So, you know, we thought the team was actually thinking about it back at CA, and they proposed adding the AR as this kind of mid-range solution, and when they did, I thought it was genius.
Yeah.
I told them I love the idea. We put it in there, and it worked really, really well. And it gives you an option also, potentially, for, it gives you an option besides just running around toting two guns, and it gives you an option beyond these hyper-deadly, headshot kill weapons,
right,
which I know as players everybody wants, but as a designer, every player being on the receiving end of a hyper-deadly weapon is not always the best design.
Yeah.
I know pro players will argue with me, but what we do here is very intentional.
There we go. The next question is, coming in. Next one is, can you switch between old and new graphics? And that comes from Chris673, and that is exclusive to campaign.
Right, you can't. So you can do that. You can't do that in the Halo 2 Anniversary stuff that we're working on.
Right.
Though you can play the old graphics in a different version.
Yeah.
In
That's
the old
right,
version.
Yeah. So if you do want to have your classic Halo 2 graphics, not only are they waiting for you in the Master Chief Collection,
right,
but you'll also have the entirety of the original Halo 2 with all the original game after Auto Update 3 with a few tweaks.
Now that does bring up another point, which is, since we have made some changes on the map, we're also really careful about making sure that even on these new versions of the map with the new visuals and everything,
right,
that you can undo those changes if you want. Are we allowed to talk about that at all, Forge?
We can speak a little about Forge, yeah.
Okay, so, you know, we've been really careful on the maps. If, for example, that that lift over in the shotgun tunnel,
yep,
you can block that off, so you can play it old school with the new graphics,
right,
if you don't want it. So,
which I think is really important. Yeah, I mean, and theoretically with Forge, you could even block off things like the waterfall if you want to.
Oh yeah, well yeah, you can disable. We've been really careful to make sure everything is modular in that, you know, in that fashion. You don't want the waterfall on here, make a custom version of the map and turn it off.
Yeah,
so.
And I think that the fans are going to be really excited about that, you know, and willing to try out the new things, but knowing that all the classic gameplay.
The flip side is, you think the switch on the waterfall belongs somewhere else?
You can go ahead and move it.
Yeah. At least I hope so.
Yeah.
Now the team back home might be yelling at me. I hope that that's the case. I guess I'll have to go find out.
Yeah, but let's see, next question comes from, let's see, Cryogre X wants to know, can we elaborate a bit on the ranking system? I think it'd be cool, Max, if we talked a little bit about kind of your design philosophy. We announced at the Xbox press briefing that we're bringing back, you know, the Halo 2 style leveling system for the Master Chief Collection.
Yeah.
And each game and each playlist is going to replicate that 1 through 50 system. Can we talk a little about your design goals for the original?
Yeah, so, you know, I know that's been talked about, and I know people miss the original system, but until we started talking about it for this product, I don't think I realized how much people missed it.
Yeah.
But yeah, I actually designed the original Halo ranking system. Back in the day, I put some of my statistics class from college to work and did a whole lot of design, a whole lot of modeling and everything, and apparently it worked out pretty nicely. So yeah, we're bringing it back. You know, the original system, it's all a what at the time I called a modified ELO system.
Yep.
ELO being the RPAD ELO, it's the chess ranking system.
Yep. I think I even remember reading that in the Halo 2 guidebook.
Yep.
It said it was a modified
ELO. Yeah, and actually years ago I posted an article on LegendNet that actually talked about matchmaking and another one about the ranking system.
Actually, you're right. That's where I read
it. That's where you probably read it.
That is where
I read it. And I revealed there's no secrets in the ranking system. Every single detail of the ranking system is in that article. So when my engineers were working on it, Sir Infinity, working on the ranking system, I actually just handed the programmer who was working on it that article and said, this is basically a spec.
Uh-huh.
And it was quite helpful. Though after we shipped, we did an update to the ranking system, so we had to figure out how to work that in there too.
Yeah.
But yeah, you know, my goal when I was working on that ranking system was absolute complete transparency.
Mm-hmm.
Everything should feel intuitive. People should understand it intuitively. You win, you gain rank. You lose, you go down.
Yep.
And then there were some niceties we put in there for new players to make the penalty for losing not be overly severe.
Right.
But eventually you would graduate from the minor leagues to the major leagues, and then you were playing what I termed basically a true zero-sum system, where what you would lose and what you would gain were equivalent. I think it was right around rank 15, if I recall, where everything, you know, what you would win and what you'd lose were equal and equivalent, and it was just complete transparency and predictability, and I think that's what people liked about it.
Yeah.
I don't know, you tell me.
You
liked it, right?
I think that's exactly what it is. I mean, when you first hop in and you kind of, and you know, maybe you do well in your first match and you kind of see your level two, you're like, man, I want to keep going.
Positive reinforcement early on, that was one of the goals.
Yeah, so I think, you know, and based off of the response that we've seen from fans, I think people are excited to have it back, not only in Halo 2 Anniversary, but the entire Master Chief Collection.
Yep. That's going to be really cool.
It was exciting to be able to announce that. And, of course, as we get closer to launch, we're going to have also some more details on that. We got some more questions. Let's see. The next one from Dexhaven. Max, you might know this. Do the grenades bounce on the same on all surfaces, grass, rock, puddle, and water? Well, there's a lot of surfaces there. Let's go find out.
I don't think they do, actually. Throw a grenade in the water.
Yeah, so a short skip there. You know,
there you go.
It dies pretty quick. If you want to take a look at how it fades on the grass, like, that's a plasma.
I suspect...
I'll get the nearest frag grenade in the snipe hut.
I know the water's different, but I think the rest of the surfaces are probably the same.
And if you look
for a frag.
Let's see.
That's a great question. I'm going to have to go look into that
one. Go ahead and see how something bounces on the rock up here if you want to see. Kind of have that full skip on.
I love bouncing grenades, so now I'm going to have to go play around and test this out.
Yeah, I'm going to now go need to go hunting for frag grenades in the hut. One sec.
Yeah.
Last thing we'll test. I think I've got time for one last question. I think it's a good one.
Sure.
Let's see. Let's make sure we know who asked it.
Sorry for all the interruptions, folks.
Yeah,
technical.
Sorry about that. Thanks for sticking with us, though.
Yeah.
We got Betrayed by Mope. He wants to know, is the spawn system and the spawn points, are they close to the same in Halo 2 Anniversary as they were in the original?
Oh, that's a big question.
Yeah.
Let's see. The spawn system itself is very, very similar to the original.
And you designed the original as well,
I did. That's an interesting story there. Just to answer the question, the points themselves have moved around some very deliberately. Tried to be really, really careful again, but, all right, a little bit of backstory.
Yeah.
So when spawn system's really interesting, because as I was telling you earlier, I think that it's one of the things that really made Halo 2 multiplayer so popular.
Right.
It made such
kind
a good experience.
Subtle things that people
but
might not
so
realize.
Subtle that, people didn't realize. So when I started, this was after coming off of Halo 1, when I was looking at multiplayer, the way that the spawn system worked in Halo 1 was there were a bunch of spawn points on the map, and any point that had somebody standing on it or a vehicle on it would get blocked.
Oh yeah, yeah, I'm sorry.
And all of the other
would give you that bubble spawn.
No. All of the other points on the map, you would just randomly choose from.
Right.
That was it. Like, it was that simple.
Yep.
So it's basically just random spawns.
Yeah.
So when on Halo 2, I had to build on that system as a foundation. I didn't have the engineering resources to design something brand new.
Yeah.
So what I did is I designed a system that I called the spawn influencer system, where now you had these
values. Yeah.
Yeah, it's kind of like a heat map where all these different things could have positive and negative impacts on the probabilities that any given spawn point would get chosen. So, like a friend would have a positive influencer around him, and all the spawn points that fall within that cone would be, you know, the probability would get bumped on them.
Right.
That's the basic system, although it was really hard to set up and manipulate and everything. So I did that, and then I had to set up all the spawning on all of the maps for Halo 2, because even on all the DLC, I'm the only one that understood the system.
Yeah.
It was, you know, a lot of skill went into it. But now, this time around, the nice thing is I've got a lot of smart designers working on this at CA, and they have way better tools than I ever had. I was kind of flying blind, and, you know, somebody would say, hey, I got a bad spawn, and I'd have to go and kind of guess as to what happened.
Yeah.
This time around, we have way better tools for figuring this stuff out. So the answer is yes, we have made some changes, but only changes for the better, very deliberately.
Yeah, I was talking to Enable earlier, a pro Halo player who's right now winning at the booth. Potentially, he has already set the highest win streak, but he was saying that everything kind of feels like Halo 2, so just in terms of the flow of the map.
I think I talked to that guy. I was asking him.
Yeah, I let him know that there have been tweaks and improvements there, which I think speaks to Halo 2 overall. Talking to you and David Mertz, it sounds like you know, the philosophy that if a change is to be made, it has to improve gameplay is pretty incredible.
Yeah, I mean, the basic philosophy is if it ain't broke, don't fix it.
Yep.
And that's why we've been so careful with this stuff, because a lot of this stuff, I mean, they're maps that are better than others, but the maps that we've chosen, for the most part, they're not broken.
Yeah.
So the, you know, little subtle tweaks here and there that, you know, we think make it, you know, subtly better, but for the most part, pretty impressive how well this stuff is aged.
Yeah, it has aged well, and it's also shaping up, I mean, in terms of the anniversary product to be quite awesome.
Yeah, I'm super excited. The best thing, just seeing it down there playable on the show, you know, seeing people playing it hands-on, and then walking around looking at all these other games, it looks like, I mean, I think visually, it can hold its own.
Oh, yeah.
And I think gameplay-wise,
I think it holds its own against
any of the top shooters out there, which is just mind-boggling.
Yeah.
That's crazy to me.
It is. Very happy about it, but it's crazy.
And
you should be. It is really cool to see it. And also just the fact that everyone gets to now get their hands on it in H2A for the first time.
Yeah, I'm excited. I'm excited for another show coming up. Have you guys announced anything about that yet?
Am I
allowed to talk about that?
No, yeah, we have a few shows coming up. But
a few shows, all right. I'll leave it at that. I'm not allowed to say anything.
Thanks so much for joining me today.
Yeah, thanks for having me. Thanks, everybody.
If you guys want to see more of Sanctuary and Ascension and Halo 2 Anniversary, be sure to check out our Sunday finals at twitch.tv/Halo at 10:30 a.m. Central European Standard Time. For the Xbox team up here, we'll see you guys later.
Yep, take care, everybody.